everyone, welcome to another session of online classes of power systems 2 subject. This is Asra Sultana, assistant professor in RIPRI department. So various methods of voltage control we have seen in the previous classes, that is excitation control, tap changing transformer, auto transformer, tap changing booster transformers, induction regulators, synchronous condenser. So in today's class I'll be discussing about the synchronous condenser, is also called as synchronous phase modifier. So few points of that also I will tell. Then use of series capacitors in long EHV transmission lines, switching in shunt reactors during light loads, switching in shunt capacitor during high load or low power factor load, and use of static shunt compensation. So all these methods we are going to see in today's class. So let us first start with the synchronous phase modifier. It is a synchronous motor running without a mechanical load. Okay, it is connected with the load at the receiving end of the line. Already synchronous condenser construction part I have already said it in the previous classes. So this is just to show you that synchronous condenser is nothing but synchronous phase modifier, as it is given in your syllabus book. So synchronous phase modifier will absorb or generate reactive power by varying the excitation of the field winding. Okay, so active power is the one which is the useful power which is given to the load, but reactive power is not a real power. Okay, it is there in the line and it will be wasted. Okay, it should be there and it should not be there, like that it is. So the synchronous phase modifier will absorb or generate the reactive power by varying the excitation of the field winding, and it will keep the voltage as constant at any condition of the load, and it will also improve power factor. So whenever we are keeping the voltage as constant, ultimately it will lead to a condition of improvement of power factor. What is power factor? So power factor is nothing but active power by apparent power, or we can say it as a cosine of angle between voltage and current in an AC circuit. So already in detail about power factor we have seen in the previous subject in PS1, I think. So power factor is nothing but what in AC circuit, so to the power we are multiplying by some factor, so that is cos phi, and it is equal to active power by apparent power. Synchronous phase modifier will absorb or generate the reactive power by varying the excitation of the field winding, and synchronous phase modifier will keep the voltage as constant at any condition of the load, and it will improve the power factor. Synchronous condenser is also known as synchronous compensator or synchronous phase modifier. Okay, so synchronous condenser or synchronous compensator is a synchronous motor which is running without any mechanical load. Construction of synchronous condenser and synchronous phase modifier is same, and it can generate or absorb reactive volt amperes, that is VAR, by varying the excitation of the field winding. Let us see the next one, series compensation. So what is series compensation? It is a method of improving the system voltage by connecting a capacitor in series with a transmission line. So to the transmission line we are keeping a capacitor in series, in other words we can say that series compensation, reactive power will be inserted in series with the transmission line for improving the impedance of the system. Okay, so instead of saying as capacitor in series with the transmission line, we can say it as a reactive power we are inserting in series with the transmission line for improving the impedance of the system. So series compensation technique will also improve the power transfer capability of the line, and it is mostly used in extra high voltage line and ultra high voltage line, that is EHV and UHV lines. So when we see the advantages of series compensation, they are having many advantages, like it increases transmission capacity, improves the system stability, control voltage regulation, and ensure proper load division among parallel feeders. So these advantages we are going to see in detail. First one is increase in power transfer capability. Second is improvement in system stability. Third is load division among parallel lines. And fourth one is control of voltage. So let us see the first one, increase in power transfer capability. Power transfer over a line is given as P1 is Vs Vr by XL sine delta. Vs is sending end voltage, Vr is receiving end voltage, XL is inductive reactance, and into angle of sine delta. So we are not going deep into these topics, see compensation topics. So this is there in your next semester, so one subject is there, power system operation and control. In detail you can see in that subject all these topics. Okay, so here P1 is power transferred per phase in watts, Vs is sending end voltage, VR is receiving end voltage, XL is the series inductive reactance of the line, and delta is the phase angle between VS and VR. If a capacitor having a capacitive reactance XC is connected in series with the line, reactance of the line will be reduced from XL to XL minus XC. And the power transfer is given as VS VR by XL minus XC into sine delta. Okay, so this is a single line diagram showing the receiving end voltage, sending end voltage, reactance of receiving sending end, reactance of receiving end. Okay, and XC is the capacitive reactance. XL1 and XL2 are the reactances of L1 and L2 respectively. Now P1 by P2 can be written as XL by XL minus XC, that is you divide the numerator and denominator by XL, so it will become 1 divided by 1 minus XC by XL, that is equal to 1 by 1 minus K. What is K here? K is XC by XL. So the factor K is known as degree of compensation or compensation factor. So per unit compensation is given by the equation K equal to XC by XL per unit. And compensation is given by the equation XC by XL per unit into 100%. XL is your total series inductive reactance of the line per phase. XC is the capacitive reactance of the capacitor bank per phase. So in practical applications, K will lie between the value 0.4 and 0.7, and for K having the value 0.5 above, P2 by P1 equal to 1 by 1 minus K, that is 1 divided by 1 minus 0.5, 2. So power transfer will be doubled by 50% compensation. Second advantage of series compensation, improvement in system stability. So for same power transfer and for the same value of sending and receiving end voltage, phase angle delta in the case of series impedance line will be less than that for the uncompensated line, and reduced value of delta will give the higher stability. Third is load division among parallel lines. Series capacitors are used in transmission systems for improving the load division between parallel lines. So when the new line with large power transfer capability is paralleled with an already existing line, so it is difficult to load the new line without overloading the old line. So in such case, series compensation will reduce the series reactance, and proper load division among parallel circuit can be done easily. So what you are doing here? Load division among parallel lines. They are used, that is series capacitors are used in transmission system for improving the load division between parallel lines. Suppose that already existing parallel line is there and we are putting in parallel another new line. So it is very difficult to load the new line without overloading the old line. So what is happening at that time? Series compensation will reduce the series reactance, and proper load division among parallel circuit can be done easily. So load division will increase the power transfer capability of the system, and losses can also be reduced. Control of voltage. So in our subject, for this PS2 we need this, that is where it is used. Series compensation is used to control the voltage. In series capacitor, there is an automatic change in volt ampere reactive power with the change in load current. So voltage will drop due to sudden load variations. Location of series capacitor. Where this series capacitor have to be located in the transmission line. So let us see that. So location of series capacitor will depend upon the economic and technical consideration of the line. Series capacitor can be located at receiving end, sending end, or at the center of the line. Sometimes they can be located at more or two or more points along the line. Okay, it is not compulsory that only one series capacitor is there in a line. It can be located at sending end, receiving end, or at the center of the line. It can be one, two, or more than two points. It can be located at more than two points along the line. So degree of compensation and the characteristics of the line will decide the location of the capacitors. Their installation at the terminal will provide the facility of maintenance, but overvoltage appearing across the terminals of capacitor under fault condition will overstress the capacitor. Capacitors are installed in the intermediate switching station of comparatively long lines, and location at the center of line can reduce the rating of the capacitor. So if the series capacitor is located at the center, then rating of the capacitor may be reduced, and that rating can be given as 3 QC is equal to 3 I square XC into 10 power minus 6 MVAR, mega volt ampere reactive. I is the line current here. Capacitor banks consist of small units which are connected in series, parallel or both to get the desired voltage and volt ampere reactive rating. Let us see the production schemes for series capacitor. So these are the various production schemes for series capacitor during abnormal condition. So what is the meaning of abnormal condition? If a fault occurs, okay, or overload, light load, over voltage, like that. So when the fault or overload occurs, large current will flow across the series capacitor of the line. Thus, excessive voltage drop will occur across the transmission line. For protecting the capacitor from such abnormal voltages or spark gaps, a surge diverter are connected to the capacitor terminal. Circuit breaker is also connected in parallel with it. Some of the methods of series capacitors are shown in this diagram. You can see here. The methods are shown for the protection of series capacitor. Switching in shunt reactors during light loads. So as grid complexity and the interconnection of renewables continues to rise, utilities are tasked with deploying equipment such as shunt capacitors, shunt reactors to provide voltage control, reactive power compensation and stability to their systems. Okay, there are three main important points here: voltage control, reactive power compensation and stability of the system. So all these three are obtained by using a shunt, by putting the shunt capacitor or the shunt reactors in the transmission lines. Shunt reactors are applied to compensate the surplus reactive power generation that may take place when lines are lightly loaded or a sudden drop in load occurs due to failure somewhere on the system. So, shunt reactors are used to compensate the reactive power generation that took place whenever the light load or sudden load is given to the transmission line and because of some failure in the system. So this phenomenon is called as Ferranti effect, which occurs when the capacitive line charging current of the line is more than the load's associated current, and this will result in a voltage at the receiving end of the line higher than the sending end voltage. Okay, so now receiving end voltage will be more than the sending end voltage. So to avoid a condition of excessively high voltage that can damage equipment, we are using a shunt reactor to draw an inductive current to offset the capacitive line charging current. Typical applications for shunt reactors include long transmission lines with system voltages of 220 kV and above, and long cable systems, as well as highly dense large urban networks where excess voltage rise can occur when a failure occurs on the system. So what are the applications for shunt reactors? Long transmission lines which are having a voltages of above 220 kV and long cable systems and large urban networks where excess voltage rise can occur when a failure occurs on the system. So each of these applications require to some extent the switching in and switching out or energizing and de-energizing of the reactor to react to changes in system loading. So, the selection of a proper shunt reactor for a particular application should be done. It is equally important as the selection of a switching device suitable for switching the small inductive currents of the shunt reactor. So, what we are telling here, as important the selection of the proper shunt reactor is for the application, equally important is the selection of a switching device suitable for switching the small inductive currents of the shunt reactor. Now let us see what is a shunt reactor. Shunt reactor is the inductive current element which is connected between the line and the neutral. Shunt reactor will compensate the inductive current from the transmission line or underground cables. So it is mainly used in the long distance, extra high voltage and ultra high voltage transmission lines for reactive power control. So what is the meaning of compensation here? So compensation means what? If something is happening, increase or decrease is happening, then reactor will, if it is increased, then it will decrease. If it is decreased, then it will increase. That is called as compensation. So shunt reactor is an inductive current element which is connected between line and the neutral. It can be any line R, Y, B. And shunt reactor will compensate the inductive current from the transmission line or underground cables. It is mostly used in long distance, extra high voltage and ultra high voltage transmission lines for reactive power control. Shunt reactors are used in the sending end substation, receiving end substation and in the intermediate substation of long EHV and UHV lines. So, shunt reactors are used in sending end substation, receiving end substation and in the intermediate substation of EHV and UHV lines. In long transmission line, shunt reactor will be connected at the distance of 300 km to limit the voltage at an intermediate point. Switching in shunt capacitors during high load or low power factor load. Shunt capacitors are the capacitors which are connected in parallel with the line. They are installed at receiving end substation, distribution substation and in the switching substations. Shunt capacitor injects the reactive volt ampere to the line. It will be placed in the three-phase bank. So what is a shunt capacitor or a capacitor bank? A capacitor bank is a very essential equipment of an electrical power system. Power required to run all the electrical appliances is the load, as useful power is active power. Active power is expressed in kilowatt or megawatt. Okay, we know that active power is the useful power and the reactive power is the kilovolt ampere reactive power. That is, it is represented by Q and active power is represented by P. Impedance triangle, if you see, there we can understand that addition of these active and reactive power will be equal to apparent power S. Okay, so maximum load connected to the electrical power system is mainly inductive in nature, such as electrical transformer, induction motors, synchronous motor, electric furnaces, fluorescent lighting are all inductive in nature. So in addition to this, inductance of different lines will also contribute inductance to the system. So, because of these inductances, system current lags behind the system voltage. So, what we are telling is that all the loads, like majority of the loads connected to the electrical power system are inductive in nature, like transformer, induction motors, synchronous motors, furnaces, electric furnaces, fluorescent lighting. So, all these are inductive in nature. So, in addition to these, inductance of different lines will also contribute to the inductance of the system. So, inductance of the load and inductance of the line both combined and the system will become more inductive in nature. So, because of these inductances, system current will lag behind the system voltage. As the lagging angle between voltage and current increases, power factor will decrease. Okay. So, what is happening in an inductor? In an inductive, current will lag the voltage. Now, as the lagging angle between this voltage and current is increasing, power factor will decrease. As the electrical power decreases, for same reactive power demand, system will draw more current from the source. So, more current we are taking from the source, so more line losses will be occurring. So, poor electrical power factor will cause poor voltage regulation. So, to avoid these difficulties, electrical power factor of the system should be improved. Okay. And usually it is maintained at unity or nearer to unity. As a capacitor causes current to lead the voltage, capacitive reactance can be used to cancel the inductive reactance of the system. So what capacitor is doing now? To cancel this inductive we are using a capacitor and it will be used to cancel the inductive reactance of the system. Capacitor reactance can be used to cancel the inductive reactance of the system. So, capacitor reactance is generally applied to the system by using static capacitor in shunt or in series with the system. So, we are using static capacitors in shunt or in series to compensate the system because it is entirely becoming now inductive in nature. We don't want that to happen because what is happening when it is becoming inductive in nature, angle between voltage and current is getting increased and power factor is getting decreased. So, we don't want less power factor, we want the power factor to be maintained at unity. So, we are using a capacitors. It can be either shunt or series capacitor. So, instead of using a single unit of capacitor per phase of the system, it is quite effective to use a bank of capacitor units in the view of the maintenance and erection. So, we are not using one capacitor we are using a bank of capacitor units so that it can be maintained easily. So this group or bank of capacitor units is called as capacitor bank. Switching in shunt capacitors during high load or low power factor loads. So how to determine rating of required for capacitor bank? Size of the capacitor bank can be determined by the following formula, that is Q is equal to P into tan theta minus tan theta dash, where Q is the required kilovolt ampere reactive, P is the active power in kilowatt, cos theta is the power factor before compensation, cos theta dash is the power factor after compensation. Now we will see the use of static shunt compensation having static capacitors. So static shunt compensation is one of the power electronic based technology which is used in flexible AC transmission system. So short form of this is FACTS, F-A-C-T-S, FACTS. So FACTS controller is connected to the power line to realize a reactive power compensation. So objective of using shunt compensator is to increase the transmittable power, increase the transient stability, increase the system stability, and hence reduce the losses. Volt ampere reactive compensator is used for voltage regulation, dynamic voltage control, and damp power oscillation. Examples can be STATCOM and SVC. So this shunt compensation is used to improve the power factor. So in shunt compensation, FACTS are connected in parallel with power system and works like a controllable current source. There are two types of shunt compensation. If the inductive load is connected, lagging load current will flow to compensate this shunt capacitor. And if capacitor load is connected, leading current load current will flow to compensate this shunt inductor in use. Okay. So what we are telling here is that there are two types of shunt compensation. In first one, what we are seeing here, whenever the inductive load is connected, if the inductive load is connected, the lagging load current will flow to compensate the shunt capacitor used. Okay. So to compensate the lagging load, shunt compensator is used. And if the capacitor load is used, connecting the leading load current flows to the compensate this shunt inductor in use. So if it is more inductive, then capacitor is used. If it is more capacitive, then inductor is used, okay, for compensation and making it as neutral. Usually for compensation, I hope this is clear. Inductive is there means we are doing capacitance, we are adding capacitance. If it is capacitive, we are adding inductance. That is called as compensation. If the power system is lightly loaded, then fixed or switched shunt reactor is used for maintaining voltage level. And if the power system is heavily loaded, then fixed or switched shunt capacitor is used for maintaining voltage level. So objective of using shunt compensator is to increase the transmittable power, increase the transient stability, increase the system stability, and to reduce the losses. VAR compensator is used for voltage regulation, dynamic voltage control, and damp power oscillation. So various example of shunt compensation is STATCOM and SVC. Thank you everyone for watching the video. So I hope today's class is clear to everyone. Give your attendance in comment section. So by next class, I'll be finishing this fourth unit to students. So maybe by tomorrow. Okay. So I will finish the fourth unit. Then we will see the fifth unit. So I hope today's class is clear to everyone. So all the voltage control methods we have studied in this three classes. So three classes I have done with the voltage control methods of a power system: excitation control, tap changing transformer, auto transformer tap changing, booster transformer, induction regulator, synchronous condenser or synchronous phase modifier, series capacitors, shunt reactors, shunt capacitors, static shunt compensation. Okay, these are all we covered, all these 10 methods of voltage control. So not only are controlling the voltage, they are also improving the power factor, and also they are improving the stability in the power system. Okay, so all these very important points we have seen. So synchronous phase modifier is a synchronous motor which is running without a mechanical load, and it will be connected with the load at receiving end of the line. So this is also very, very important. Location of the voltage control equipment, where it is located, whether it is located at sending end or whether it is located at receiving end or it is located at the intermediate state. So that is also very, very important. So we are not only improving the voltage control, we are improving the power factor, we are improving the stability. Okay. So synchronous phase modifier will absorb or generate the reactive power by varying the excitation of the field winding. Series compensation we have seen. Series compensation is the method of improving the system voltage by connecting a capacitor in series with the transmission line. So series compensation means what? Connecting the capacitor in series. Shunt compensation, connecting the capacitor in shunt. Okay. So various advantages of series compensation we have seen. So increase in power transfer capability, improvement in system stability, load division among parallel lines, control of voltage. All these four advantages we have seen in detail. Location of series capacitor. So these can be located at sending end, receiving end, or at the center of the line. So for if whenever a fault occurs, a high voltage occurs, so what are the various protective schemes for series capacitors we have seen. Then switching in shunt reactors during light loads. So shunt capacitors and shunt reactors will provide voltage control, reactive power compensation and stability to the systems. And the phenomena is called as Ferranti effect, which occurs when the capacitive line charging current of line is more than the loads associated current. And this will result in a voltage at the receiving end of the line higher than that of the sending end voltage. So to avoid a condition of excessively high voltage that can damage equipment, shunt reactor will be used to draw an inductive current to offset the capacitive line charging current. So, applications for shunt reactors include long transmission lines, long cable systems and large urban networks. Shunt reactor is the inductive current element which is connected between line and neutral, and it will compensate the inductive current from the transmission line or underground cables. It is mainly used in EHV and UHV transmission lines for reactive power control. And shunt capacitors are connected in parallel with the line, and they are installed at the receiving end substation, distribution substation and in the switching substations. Capacitor bank, we are using capacitor bank in place of single capacitors because maintenance of this will be easier. So power required to run all the electrical appliances is the load, as useful power is active power. It is expressed in kilowatt or megawatt. Maximum load which is connected to the electrical power system is mainly inductive in nature, like transformers, induction motors, synchronous motors, etc. So compensate this inductive nature, we are keeping a capacitor either in series or in parallel, so that we will compensate this inductive nature, because if it is inductive in nature, power factor is decreased, poor voltage regulation is occurring, and power factor of the system has to be improved. That is why we are going for the compensation by using a capacitor bank. So we can connect the capacitor bank series or in parallel. Then we have seen the use of static shunt compensation having static capacitors. That is, it is static shunt compensation, a technique used in flexible AC transmission systems. And examples of this shunt compensation is STATCOM and SVC. Objective of using shunt compensator is to increase the transmittable power, increase the transient stability, increase the system stability, etc. And shunt compensation will improve power factor. And in shunt compensation, facts are connected in parallel with the power system and there works like a controllable current source. Two types of shunt compensation is there. If are inductive, what it is doing? It is compensating with the shunt capacitor. For capacitive load, it is compensating with a shunt inductor. So objective of the shunt compensator is to increase the transmittable power, increase the transient stability, increase the system stability and reduce the losses. Thank you everyone. Give your attendance in comment section. If you have any doubts, you can ask me, students. Thank you everyone.